to see. We all want to be real.
I should say, I guess, a little bit about myself. Since this has sort of, over the years, turned into a kind of a one-man band. I grew up in a small town in Colorado under extraordinarily ordinary circumstances. For some reason, I don't know, genetic or something in the water or something, I was always very prone to obsession, and one obsession gave way to another, so that rock collecting gave way to butterflies, which gave way to rocketry, which gave way to girls, which gave way to drugs, which gave way to politics, on and on and on. Fascinated with the world, and as a rock hunter and a butterfly collector, it was fairly aesthetically driven and irrational. What interested me was the iridescence in certain agates, certain pyrites, certain tropical butterflies, certain kinds of reef fish, something about the light, the visual thrill of the world. And this took me through many places. And I began to pursue this vast area of interlocking disciplines, the nexus of concerns that clusters around the question, what are we? Where did we come from? And where are we going? When these questions first form in your mind, a reasonable response is to seek the cultural database. Surely there are answers to these questions. Who are we? Where did we come from? And where are we going? Well, if you have any kind of intellectual filter at all, you quickly can satisfy yourself that our best efforts are nothing more than half-completed stories told around the campfire. We don't actually know what our predicament is. I mean, we are up against a phenomenon which we can barely bring into focus in our cognitive sphere, and it's the phenomenon of our own existence. And my personal journey, if you want to put it that way, lay through a successive series of, I almost said disappointments, but awakenings could be another word, as I realized that nobody has their finger on what's going on. So you can live and die inside these intellectual structures if you choose to. But people of curiosity, people of unusual or traveled circumstance, usually find themselves unsatisfied with the conventional answers. In other words, all these things you might cling to, Catholicism, democratic ideals, Hasidism, Marxism, Freudianism, you know, all of these things are exposed as simply quaint cultural artifacts, painted masks and rattles assembled by people of good intent but clearly not great grasp of the situation. Well, I thought that process of deconstruction of cultural reality would end in a kind of liberation of cynicism, where you become sort of really street smart. You know, nobody can put anything over on you. You've been there. You've done that. It turns out that that existential phase, which I reached at about age 18, is itself simply a place along the way. And that persisting then with pushing into altered states of mind and alien cultures, I began to see that there was a landscape of meaning, but it was not the meaning that I had ever been told. And liberalism takes the generous position that everybody has a piece of the action. You know, the Buddhists understand something, the Taoists understand something, the Kabbalists understand something. I was getting a different message. I was getting the message that nobody understands anything. That the entire cultural enterprise is 180 degrees cockamamie to the truth. That we have it absolutely ass backwards, that to date the enterprise of thinking has moved us radically away from understanding anything. And over the years I've tried to make room for this alternative explanation. For me, what all these years of psychedelic taking came to was a new model of how reality works, a new model of what the world is. In other words, being here now is the primary datum. And it doesn't tell you that this is a series of accidents, and that you are irrelevant, and that your pain is not pain, and that your hope is not hope. It tells you something else. It tells you this counts. Somehow it matters. I matter. My life matters. My family, culture, the human enterprise, this planet, its biota, this matters. It all matters. Meaning is intrinsic as a primary datum, and yet it's denied by the philosophy which rules this planet and sets its agenda. Anyone who has ever gone through a bankruptcy, a divorce, a love affair, the death of a loved one, something like that, knows that, you know, these things are unique phenomena. Millions of people have died, and nobody has ever died the same way twice and left the people standing there feeling the same way. The things that matter are imbued with uniqueness, and that uniqueness is imparted by this invisible medium that science, in order to function, has had to deny. That's what it basically comes down to. As I see it, being, the cosmos, whatever you want to call it, is a struggle between two implacable forces. Novelty on the one side and habit on the other side. What is habit? Habit is doing things the way you've always done them. Habit is tradition. Habit is circular behavior. Habit is following the creodes that have already been laid down by past activity. It's what Sheldrake calls the morphogenetic field. What is novelty? Novelty is self-explanatory. It's what breaks the pattern. New connections, new possibilities. And the universe is in a state of dynamic tension between these two tendencies. Do you think you are repeating the lifestyles and algorithms of your parents and grandparents ad infinitum back to Adam?
Or do you feel like you've stepped to the front of the train of human evolution, that you are making yourself new every day?
Yourself, good, thank you very much. Thanks.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. Do you hear us well? Is everything fine?
Yes, I can hear you both fine, I think. Yeah.
Awesome. Yes. How's the weather? How's the energies in South Africa now?
So, did you say there?
How's the weather and how's the energy in South Africa at the moment?
Right. Okay, so we have summer here at the moment. Mm-hmm. And the energy, well, it's the new year. So, you know, in South Africa, that we take vacation time is and school holidays over the December period. So it's not just for Christmas and New Year's. It's for, you know, most of the month of December. And so we kind of just, well, the country's kind of just settling back into the 9 to 5 and whatnot. So at the moment, the routine, the usual, I just did a video called Conditioned by the Calendar. Which was sort of inspired me to do the talk because I just feel at the moment that the energy is pretty intense. In a sense, it's like, you know, the denial of being back to business as usual. You know, the money has, you know, now being a bit sort of out of pocket because you're spending all the money on vacation and Christmas and New Year's and the indulgence of the end of the year. Vacation time, so I think it's quite stressed, I would say, and also I think a bit despairing at the same time. I think people are a little bit strung out, so I mean, that's just kind of, I don't feel the excitement that people necessarily feel at this, you know, ready for the new year and whatnot. You know, I think the times have changed, so that's kind of the energy. And I think once January goes past, you know, once it moves on, people might feel a bit, okay, now we got sort of maybe 11 more months till the end of the year or something like that. So I don't know. It's kind of a desperate situation sometimes when you think about it, but in that regard.
And it certainly has to do with our calendar that we're using all over the world, or most over the world. We've actually had a show, I think, 1.5 years or almost 2 years back, about that and how the calendar influences, you know, how we're thinking, how we're doing as a unit, so to speak. And there's certainly a lot of work to be done. People realize that just how we look at a calendar is kind of, you know, what runs this whole thing.
I mentioned in my talk as well. I mean, if you think about it, we're conditioned from childhood, you know, going from school year and the school bell, and then, you know, the days of the week, and then the weekend. And then also I get into the fact of, like, you know, when it's our birthdays or when it's sort of Valentine's Day, you know, these kind of special days where you have a moment where you can feel like, you know, you're the king or queen of the world, or it's your birthday, you know, or you can, you know, it's Valentine's Day, you can be romantic, you know, or it's Easter or it's Christmas, you can be giving. And so we've been conditioned from way back about the calendar, which gives us our sort of the beat to where we to which we dance to. Absolutely.
I learned that when I came over to the States, which is like 10 years ago. Originally I'm from Germany, and I observed that there's so many more days, you know, free days they call it, when we're free, so to speak, and it's just in between. You don't even have time to let one come and go, and just it was crazy. It was like, what, another one already? And not going to work today, that's crazy. So many years.
For sure. Okay, so you're from the States, Stefan?
Yes.
Okay, and Christina, I think your Skype says you're from Lithuania.
Yes, Yeah, from Europe.
From Europe, okay, very nice. Okay, as you know, I'm from South Africa, Johannesburg.
Yeah, wonderful.
Yes. One of the few that I've met of myself around this area, or that I've even come across, is I just don't find a lot of South Africans from my town, I would say, or city in a sense, that are really into the same research or interests in a sense. So, yeah. It's nice to find like-minded people, and that's where I do find them, is on the internet.
Right, and that's why we're doing that. I mean, we're spanning a great triangle here all over the world pretty much, and that's our chance to connect and kind of present what our ideas are and have it somewhere where people can access it. That's all what it's about. I think for us it's the first in South Africa, if I'm not mistaken,
mm-hmm.
and that's
yeah.
where you are. And so let's go with a little intro about you for our listeners here.
Sure.
Yeah, so good day everyone, and thank you for joining OpThink Radio. And you know, it's a pleasure to have such guests tonight. It's Aron Gochin. And Aron, you are an amazing soul. I just stumbled accidentally on your videos on YouTube when I was listening to Manly P. Hall lectures, and I was more than amazed of how you were able to combine, you know, music with his words into one philosophical talk. And then I saw that you do yourself your own talks, which are no less amazing than such talks like, you know, Manly P. Hall himself. So I was hooked on from the very first one of your talks. And Aron is a true life philosopher and an artist of mind and heart. And what is beyond outstanding and beautiful about Aron is that he is not playing any sort of teacher or guru. He's just like all of us, talks with his audience by angle of humble openness from heart to heart. No ego and no childlike innocence, you know, just childlike innocence, you know, that playfulness, full raw openness. And he shares with us very refreshing and loving self-dialogues from his heart. And the main message he shares is that we are not alone, and when we are awakening, that we are amongst others who are awakening too, and we have to share those feelings we are having to be able to grow together and, you know, wake up faster. And, you know, we're never alone in those journeys, and just always together. And we are going for similar things and want to reach same destination, self-awareness in love, which are very crucial this day. And Aron, maybe for the beginning, you would love to share your story, you know, how everything started and how awakening happened and how everything accelerated, and you know, who are your inspirations? And so maybe we just could, you know, start from here.
Sure. Well, first let me say, Christina, thank you for that introduction. I was just thinking maybe I could, I mean, I wouldn't really, but it would be something that I could use on my channel as an introduction for those who may be first coming across, you know, my videos. I don't know. It was just very lovely. It was very kind words. So thank you very much, and it's a very warm, heartwarming. So thank you. For myself, so it's obviously quite a broad question, and I'll try and simplify it as best as I can. I suppose for myself, I've always been somewhat different in my own way, in my own being. I mean, even from a child, I had a very hard time conforming to society, to the religion that I was brought up in, to the family, you know, sort of dogma or way of thinking and whatnot. And never did well at school, and I just kind of felt that there was something more mysterious to life than people were letting on about. And so I didn't really enjoy school, and I didn't really fit into any sort of mold in a way. And that came with its own challenges and its own stories and whatnot. But nonetheless, always been kind of somewhat of a searcher and an explorer, and feeling that life is an adventure that most people are not necessarily, you know, journeying on or answering the call in a sense, and playing it small. And so for myself, you know, I went through the whole rituals of schooling and tried a little bit of university and whatnot, and tried to find myself a stable job and relationship, which was, you know, not very rewarding in a sense, or wasn't very successful at it. I just couldn't fit the mold, and I sort of for myself found that I was the problem, that there was something wrong with me. And I suppose that was because I had no real other people's input or influences in my life of others that have, if you want to call it, awakened or seen something else to life. And so for myself, I just thought I was a lost wanderer on the way. And in my early teens, I picked up a couple of self-help books that I didn't find had much merit or value to them or substance really. And I was kind of, to be honest, really giving up. I mean, this was slowly when, you know, in South Africa, we were introduced to the internet, but we didn't really have much of a connection, well, a bandwidth or anything like that. You only really were able to send your emails. So it wasn't until a bit later on, which I'll get to, whereby I came across my inspirations and on the internet, and which kind of, that's where I suppose the genie was let out the bottle and sort of taken the plunge into the rabbit hole, if you will. And so that was in about 2008, I suppose, whereby I had given up all hope in a way. I mean, I gave myself over to antidepressants as being the only solution, and alcohol, binge drinking and whatnot, and just really watching a whole bunch of movies to kind of, you know, distract myself and get through it all. Mm-hmm. I mean, the seeking was still there, but I just found it very, you know, I didn't find what I was looking for. And I was at the end of my rope. I mean, it really was, I was just not in a good state of mind, in body, in spirit whatsoever. But I felt that there was nothing to go on. This was it, you know, that it was like a bit of a bum deal, you know, that there was nothing, there was no mystery. I've been searching for this pot at the end of the rainbow, in a sense, and it was my own, you know, imagination. I convinced myself, and there was nothing more to it. But always, I suppose, the heart inside of me, you know, the spirit was calling and whatnot. So it was almost at the end of my rope, at the last sort of, I would say, you know, yeah, it was a very tough place that I was at, and there was no hope, in a sense. And what happened was I downloaded an Alan Watts lecture for the first time, which I actually thought it was Alan Watts. Mm. And it turned out to be mislabeled, and it turned out to be Terence McKenna. Wow. Yeah, so, no, sorry, I got the story wrong. I got it wrong. I downloaded David Icke by mistake. I don't actually know what happened, but it was mislabeled. Mm-hmm. And anyways, I started listening to this guy named Terence. I don't know who the hell he was, and I was listening to it on my phone, and I was just blown away. I was on vacation at the time, and I said this is the holy grail. Yeah. In a way, you know, I was like, and I thought, by the time when I get back into the city, this is when we did have internet, I have to research this guy, so which I did. And from there it all started kind of unraveling, I would say, and the journey in full force began, and it came loud and proud, came knocking on the door, in fact, you know, barging its way through, inviting itself into my life, in that way. And so that's where I suppose it was liftoff for me, and the unfolding from there kind of took place. I could get more into detail. I don't know if there's anything specific I could chat about. I mean, any question?
No, I mean, Terence McKenna will do that for you, and he's a great one that can absolutely show you, you know, there is something else. Wait a minute, there is something else to think about, and he's great. And then you go online and you figure out, oh man, he has hours and hours of presentation. So, you know, now you're like, yes.
Yes, it was, and that's actually how my YouTube channel started. It was, you know, I was just marveled by this man's mind and the work that he had done and he had put across. And my fear was that nobody, not enough people knew about him. And I felt that I owed him a sense of gratitude and a sense of service, in a way, to sort of get more exposure on his videos and the man himself. And so I started with taking just audio clips of his videos and putting them together with music and visuals as well. And that's actually how my channel began. And I'm proud to say, as a side note, it's not of my doing in a way, but on YouTube, the Terence McKenna video, Trust Yourself, is the most watched or highest views of any other Terence McKenna material online.
Mm.
So that for myself, and it's got really nothing to do with me, in a sense. I think I was just kind of the messenger, the conduit, in a way. And so Terence McKenna has been a main figure in my life. When you talk about influences, there's been many, but Terence McKenna was the man who sort of kick-started it all for me and whatnot. So it's been an amazing journey.
Yeah, wonderful. And now as the question steps in, you know, we talk a lot about, you know, the energies of the planet Earth in our shows. And also Terence McKenna talks about plants and, you know, ecosystem and, you know, fractal nature of plants. So what are your intakes here and, you know, how that fractal nature is working with planet Earth? And what are the energies at the moment, you know, on the planet? How you feel that in your heart and how that, you know, fractal nature is echoing in our hearts? And what steps we should take to, you know, unite more together and, you know, work with planet more?
Yeah, well, that's a very big question, which I'm still working out on myself as well. There's so many angles and perspectives and layers to it. For myself, I would say that I was very much of the mind as well that a new wave of energy is arriving on the planet, especially in the year 2012. That was, I find, a massive change and shift in consciousness. I found for myself as well, whereby I was perhaps struggling with concepts or ideas or certain growth, I would say, that for myself it was when that year came and went, you know, and the following years, I just found that the expansiveness was just incredible. It just felt that there was an opening, if you will, of energy arriving on the planet, and it was almost like, you know, for those who wish to ride this roller coaster, in a sense, I really feel that it was it's been an opportunity for people to say, okay, there is something that will support you in this time, and it's loaded with magic and it's loaded with synchronicity. And it's loaded with all the good stuff and connectedness and love and community of like-minded and like-souled individuals. And so for myself, I just found that was sort of a tipping point in a way. Maybe it was in my imagination, but I just found again that I was meeting up with the right people, the right information was coming to me, and the healing, my own inner healing, was really taking a progressive and effective, how would you say, a route or process, in a sense. So that's what I would say on that end. And I would say that I would think, an urgency, to say the least, of like-minded souls and beings to come together as a sense of community. We almost are each other's, what do you call it, when you come across in the desert and you find some palm trees and to rest under, and there's a little bit of water, we are each other's oases, in a sense, so to speak. And we are each other's, we are students to one another and teachers at the same time. And we all have something in common, right? And this is a common thread that I think that joins us all together. And it's an open-mindedness, it's an open-heartedness, and it's also, I think, an understanding as well that we are very, very important right now, who we are at this time in history of where we are at, as sort of the more sensitive, the more compassionate, the more awakened souls, in a sense. I don't like to use the word awakened in a way, but the ones that are tapped into, again, that the deeper mystery of life. I think that we play a very, very important and significant role, and comes with that role a great responsibility. And so it's not just on our own personal level, which is, I think, the primacy and the first and foremost importance. But then I think it's for, you know, the whole of history, and it's the whole of mankind in a way. I mean, I think it's maybe a bit of a grandiose idea, but it's not. I think that we hold the qualities and the virtues of which we've been handed down from the great teachers and you know, the great philosophers and the psychologists and the shamans of previous generations. And I think it lies with us now. And so we hold the flames of consciousness, if you want to call it, burning bright, and bright enough for all those others that are now, you know, kind of awakening at the same time, to see the light and to say there is hope. there is other people that are on this journey. There is this feeling that I feel deep inside, you know, others are feeling it too. Even though, you know, my local friends and peers or culture or society, societal groups or whatnot, I don't resonate with them. And they don't understand, and they look at me like maybe a bit of a crazy person or something like that, even a heretic, heaven forbid, you know, conspiracy theorist or, you know, something like that. Whatever, it's for those people, you realize, no, there's a tribe, there is a community, and you're very much welcomed, you know. And so I think that's the importance of our being here. I don't think it's just by chance, and I don't think that we're doing it on our own. I think we are being aided by, again, what we're saying, this energy that has arrived on the planet. And it's not saying that it's going to be easy necessarily, I mean, we all know that, but it's definitely going to be rewarding, and to keep the faith alive, I would say, and the hope and the trust as well alive. And that's kind of would be my two cents worth.
Now, what's interesting in your talks, you know, in one of your talks, you were talking about the awakening and how in your story it was like you awoke, you know, in yourself, and you saw lots of illusions, and you started, you know, dig things and seek for information, and then you felt that urge to share that with people because you've, you know, so to speak, went to that other stage when you, from one, you know, stage from inward, you again go to outward, and you want to share with people, you want to talk, to, you know, grow together, and then again go inside. So that's very important stages, and they also just resemble that fractal nature of us, like we go from inside to outside, and the importance of finding those people, you know, because when we are not, you know, able to find that surroundings or those people who can understand us, we can, you know, just shed that energy again inside of us, and just to make that process, you know, even longer and maybe sometimes even more painful. So what are your intakes here?
I definitely agree. I think that we can find a sense of I would say the feeling of home in a way. I don't know what that really means in a sense, but in one another. We can find a sense of familiarity, you know, a sense of, how would you put it? It's a pure type of, let me just think about it. It's, yeah, I just, yeah, this is a big theme in my talks about the importance of having, you know, like-minded or like-soul people in our lives. It's,
to me, it's like, you know, like heart pulse, you know, it's just like, you know, has pulse, and then again, it rests. Like, it, when it rests, we go inside, and when it pulses, we are seeking that urge to go to, you know, talk with our mirrors, and when we see it, that reflection, we are again, you know, pulsing again to see ourselves within, and from the reflection to the, you know, the object itself. So that was very interesting when you talked about, you know in your shows, and how that, and you know, all that fractal, you know, mirroring just is happening, is amazing.
Yes, it's a reflection process that goes on. It's you know, I just think that, look, I try not to mince my words about it and be realistic, but also not be despairing about it, just to call a spade and to see what, you know, the reality is. And, you know, from my own experience, I would say it's the feeling of that deep isolation and ostracization as well. And, you know, feeling a little bit like a round peg in a square hole, and also somewhat crazy in a sense. And, you know, given our upbringings, I think for most people, you know, that I've come across, even for myself, we do come from a system that we've been heavily compromised by, right? And we've been conditioned, I would say, to carry a very heavy weight and a shadow, which is not our own necessarily. It's been put upon from society, and the expectations from society and from our parents and upbringing and whatnot. And so my method in a sense, I would say, is the self first, in a way, is to be able to see what it is that doesn't align with our true nature and our true spirit. What is it that we've been conditioned? How is it that we've been made to be identified with a narrative and a story that is not of, you know, of our own making and our own choosing? And that which, that story, that narrative, which is, you know, can suffocate us at times, that which is the subconscious, which drives us, which gives us our sort of motivation in life. And so my channel, I suppose, very much is about the healing process. It's about, and again, working with one another in saying that this is the way, this is the dynamic, this is how it works. And, you know, it's not just so important to know what's going on in the world, but to know what's going on with inside oneself, to see that as the most important. And so for myself, what I try and reflect in my videos, I would say, is my own personal stories, because I think that for myself, well, obviously they're the most relevant, but I think that each one of us, our own unique stories and our upbringings and what we've been through are very unique. And this is the real homework, the real deep work that we do. And so that's for myself, is that I try and, you know, I'm certainly no teacher or guru or expert at anything in a way. It's just, I suppose, you know, the importance of showing the significance of our own stories and of our own feelings and our own beliefs and our own ideas and our own creativity and our own imagination, because that's been something that we've not allowed to really been having to be embraced. You know, it's not something that we were encouraged to do. And so a lot of us have missed out on, I would say, the connection with the self, with the spirit. And that has caused many other issues to arise. And so it's not, again, to be self-conscious or, how would you say, you know, just feeling inadequate about oneself. It's to feel within the company of others, to feel the courage and the invitation to speak about our experiences and our stories and whatnot, and who we actually feel inside, and assist one another in bringing that out and manifesting that into reality at the same time. So therefore, I do feel that we are, you know, almost like angels to one another, so to speak, or teachers in a sense. I mean, we're the student and the teacher, that we help each other and assist each other and guide each other in a true manner. It's there's nothing disingenuous about it. I mean, that's what my channel, I try very much to be, is to try and be as transparent as possible. You know, it's the true motivation, the true objective here is for the personal transformation. It's for the personal preservation, I would say, at the same time. And again, that in the fractal, that we reflect that in each other. We give each other the permission to embrace the individual that we are inside, that's been sort of cast aside, you know, by society and that which we've had to play low and suppress. So for myself, I kind of, you know, that's my channel. It's an invitation to those others that they wish to celebrate their uniqueness, their individuality, to do the real healing, to do the real work, and to see what potential, you know, I often speak about potential lies with inside of ourselves. Because again, I think that when we are in touch with our potential and we are fulfilling our potential, then life is worth living, you know. Yeah. If we're not dancing to the beat of our own drum, if we're taking instructions and directions from somebody else, and we might not even feeling like we're doing it today, you know, deliberately, but there is the insecurities and the coping mechanisms that we had to learn as children and through childhood and adolescence and whatnot in order to cope in this life. And what I'm saying is that there is no judgment on that. I don't believe that there should be self-criticism about one's conditioning, you know, because sometimes you can feel insecure about, you know, who am I at the end of the day? And I'm saying we shouldn't feel insecure about it. We should feel excited about that and want to find out, you know, who am I? What am I about? What potential lies inside? And what am I a part of at the same time? A great significance for life, a great significance for being alive, for living every day. You know, it's not just a means to an end. So like, oh, well, I hope that one day, you know, there is a shift in planetary, you know, consciousness, and everybody sort of wakes up, and then I can sort of, you know, breathe a sigh of relief. Or, you know, some people prophesize the doomsday and they'll be like, okay, well then we'll be, you know, we'll be saved in a sense, or some kind of messiah or something like that coming to the forefront and you know, solving this all for us and whatnot. So it's not to be of that mind, I suppose. It's to be working day by day and trying to be inspired with what we have, and again to tap into the richness of who we are, and also the amazingness, the how would I say it, the way that it's been, you know, even for myself being in South Africa, you know, Christina, you being in Lithuania, and Stefan being in America, and all of our individual stories, and where we are right now, right? The greatest, the significance of that, it's not by chance. And so we play in such an important role, in such a important story, you know, that that there will come a time, I do believe, that in that we will have a little bit of perspective to see how amazing and how adventurous and how inspiring and how much promise and potential lies within us, and how we did hopefully fulfill that at the same time.
Yeah. And what's interesting, that every talk you know record, it has that example of that existential moment, you know, that feeling of, you know, just tapping into that. And also you talk about current moment, because to me existential moment and current moment is one and the same, when you feel, you know, here, now, you know, and current, and you are fully yourself. And also, you know, you here taps the questions again about time and its illusion, like when we are just looking from the inside to outside, and we give our energy to the time, to the illusion around us, to the world, and to the appearances. And you know what I just truly loved, how Moji said once, like, you know, we always, you know, talk about time, what time is it now in day, and you know what the season is now in the year, it's spring, it's autumn, or anything else, you know, but we never ask that question, you know, what the season is inside ourselves. You know, we never ask, is it spring or is it winter now? So, and you do ask those questions, and you do that very humbly, in a very humble way, and you know, just show that very, you know, deeply. So that's very amazing, and thank you for doing that.
Thank you.
Awesome.
It's the timelessness, you know, again. That I think it's about the it's transcending the limited sort of matrix manifesto that we all have been taught to live by. Again, that time orientation, and I like that what Muji says about what season is going on inside, and that's why from time to time I do also speak about that. There, you know, the advantage of the internet is that there is so much information available. But what is the quality of that information? How much of that information is actually useful and productive and of substance and relatable to our lives? Because I see that a lot of people, I mean, it's so easy to get distracted and overwhelmed by the state of the world in which it's in, and also to be invested in the future of the world and society and culture at large and whatnot. And so, again, I try and speak on the importance of the relevance of your own story and your own life and what's going on with inside of yourself, because that is where, you know, the pedal meets the metal. That's where the keys lie, in a sense. It's like for myself, it's like if you invested in if you on the ship going down and you're not creating your own lifeboat strategy, you know, and you're going to go down with the ship. And I think a lot of people, you know, they're entwined and they're pulled in, and they're so well associated and they're so well invested. Like, you know, well, let's say current times in America, well, what's going to happen with Trump? You know, and it's a legitimate concern, I would say, but it's not as much of a concern about maybe what's going in your own life, you know, and what's happening in your own relationships with people, and where you're holding within yourself. And so for myself, in regards to information, I mean, there's a wealth out there, but you know, we've got to be very vigilant and to see, you know, what really does resonate with us, what does inspire us, what does lift our spirits, you know, because it's easy to jump on the bandwagon and just, you know, watch and get stuck in all the news and what's going on and all the politics, and not only that, but all the celebrity news and all the gadgets that are coming out and whatnot. I mean, you know, each to their own, I suppose, but it can be it's very dangerous territory. You know, I speak about as well that I just don't think that is, you know, I mean, I'll give you this example. I was watching a movie from 2008, and I didn't know what year it was in. And I thought to myself, this was maybe in the 90s. I couldn't believe that this was, when I found out it was in 2008, the difference in 9 years, in a sense, of how much we've developed technologically and as a global mind and whatever else has gone on, consumerism and et cetera, how much the world has changed, and how we do feel that if you, you know, that kind of plugged into it, that in other words, the external changes are going on, and that seems to be the most important of significances in one's life, to be up to date with whatever's going on externally. And I see that it can be quite dangerous and whatnot, and one has to be very again vigilant and aware of where they maybe are getting lost in the trends and all that's going on, etc. I mean, I speak about Facebook as well. You know, they were just saying that in 2015, in August 27th, that there were 1 billion people on Facebook at that given time. And so for myself, I mean, if you just think about, my point being is that as the human biology, the external is advancing at such a rapid rate that we can't really keep up. We're trying our best to, and yet we're trying to, how would you say, keep up with it without,
with,
you know,
it, yeah.
And getting left behind. But in our own lives, our own relationships, our own our own story is being missed out, incredibly so. So yeah, right. I just
And not kind of fall victim to all these distractions around us, you know, that just multiply every day, and still trying to find, you know, a way to investigate your own social separation and your own separation from yourself. And sometimes then we look in the other direction. Maybe we look into the past, you know, and we look at the ancients, and we look maybe at the native groups that are around us, where we are. And I'm sure South Africa, where you live, is quite a hub of different kinds of spirituality. What can you tell us about how people see the world there, and how maybe the natives are looking at us, and what their relation is spiritually?
Yeah. So this has always been something on my mind, and something that I'm researching and looking into, the different African cultures, their sort of introduction into the digital age and into sort of the Western mind thinking and whatnot. And it's unfortunate, I must say, because look, I haven't met people that haven't, or tribes, I would say, or communities that haven't been affected somewhat by technology or television or media of any kind. And for myself, I have just found that there's been an onslaught of how would I say it? Well, I would say for themselves, a cultural death, I'm sorry to say. It's the influence from the West. I mean, I on the West in that way, but like, you know, the has been so severe and so quick and so radical that it has changed the African culture. I mean, myself, I'm South African, a white male in that sense, but like, you know, I grew up, you know, if you get into the detail, but I grew up when there was television, but there might have been only maybe one or two channels on TV, and it lasted, you know, it was only for certain hours during the day. But now you're getting, you know, African people, village people, that are getting hooked up with electricity, and immediately they're getting cable television with 55 channels with an HD, you know, type of TV screen. And I was speaking to an elder about a few years ago of a village, and he was explaining to me that, you know, television came in 5 years ago into the village, into the tribe. And he says within 5 years, we have become unrecognizable to ourselves. You know, he was saying that this is a new generation, and the way of our lives and how we have lived for so long has almost been forgotten, in a sense. So it's unfortunate. I wish I had better news on that front. You know, I wish I did, but I really see that because of the advancement and because of the fact is that, like I said, I had television when I grew up, but where tribal people didn't have television, and they didn't just start off with some kind of, you know, a few hours a day of television and maybe only local stuff, but they're seeing worldwide of what's going on, and especially American television. And I've just seen a homogenization of the individual, of the black South African, I would say, even the white as well. I mean, there's no racial division in my world for myself. I was brought up, obviously, under apartheid era, in a sense, with that great division, and I sort of worked out very early on that it's a farce, that it's not real, and there's all the other issues with it. But so for myself, it's just been an observation of seeing that a culture that has lost its way, has lost its touch with its history, has lost touch with its ancestral bloodlines, or just not bloodlines, but information. It really breaks my heart when I see on television, you know, the local soap operas or just dramas ridiculing or making, not even making fun of, but with a bad presentation of sort of what they're like, the witch doctors, you know, and the spiritual side of things, how they use this in the dramas to, you know, to make it dramatic. And like, they'll have the witch doctor with all the bones, and you know, it's all staged and whatnot. It's completely removed from what it truly really was about. And so I just see how how television, in a sense, and marketing and everything like that, has turned their culture inside out, and they're very lost, I suppose, and very misguided. And so I don't have much good news about that. You know, you go to these villages, and you see just scattered around Coca-Cola bottles and beer bottles, and all the likes of all the junk foods and whatnot, and things that have infiltrated into their villages. And then you'll hear, like, you know, they haven't maybe got electricity, but they've got some kind of solar radio, and they're listening to Rihanna. And then you see the kids that are dressed up, you know, like Beyonce, and the boys that are dressed up like Jay-Z and whatnot. And, you know, you walk in and you say, this can't be an African village, you know. And I've spent time in the country, and I've spent time with in African villages as well. And so I don't have much good news about that. And it's something that I try and in my day, I used to work with the village elders to try and still keep somewhat of their lineage intact, and we found it very, very hard to do, and whatnot. So I don't really have much good news on that front.
Well, that's sad to hear, but the more important it is, you know, for people like you and us to do this work and wade through this stuff and kind of find the old way, the ancient way in our now, and you know, become the ancients through the tool of the internet and connecting and finding it that way, you know, use it as a crutch, if you will.
Yeah, an ancient way still exists, you know, in South Africa too. We see example of, for example, Michael Tellinger work, you know, how he investigates those stones. We talk about, you know, thousands of years, and, you know, deep information we are keeping to, you know, our generation, you know, so we can just have to again turn to nature and just to again learn from that. Yeah,
you know, it's I think, again, I think if the, you know, they say when the student is ready, the teacher will appear, and I think it applies to everybody around the world globally. I just think that magic kind of does happen, and I mean that in the sense of that if there is one that's deeply seeking, that the answers will come, that will the truth will find them, and the ancestral ways or the knowledge or the information will will be, you know, delivered unto them, in a sense. Whether it's in dreams, I mean, I think about whether it's just in visions or something, or just a sense of knowing. You know, they talk about the Akashic records and whatnot, and perhaps our connection to that, and our ability to download from the Akashic records and be informed that way. Because I don't think that the true seeker is truly really limited. And no matter where you're born, maybe you don't even have the internet, but I do think that you can find, again, also through nature. Nature is an excellent teacher. You know, from the plants, from the insects, from all the different kind of species, from the weather patterns and whatnot, can be our greatest teacher, and whatnot. And so, you know, one does have the ability. There is still something in the air, if you want to call it, that one can align themselves with, and it will guide them and show them, you know, what once was and where is one to go at the same time. So it's always available. It can't really be, I would say, snuffed out, or, you know, to be completely dissolved or disappeared. I just do think it's there.
Yeah, it comes always naturally. You know, we can't force things, like you said in one of your talks, like why I wasn't allowed to meet myself before. Like it should have happened, you know, the way it happened, and it just happened so magically via a synchronistic way. Just, you know, it had to be that way.
It has to be that way. It's otherwise, I just found that it's, you know, and you know what, it's not that what I mean is that it's not because we might not have access to information and knowledge and wisdom and things like that, depending on where you are in the world, etc. I just think that there is an inside the person, again, inside the individual, the spirit, if you want to call it that, that if one gets in touch with that, it allows, in other words, the spirit to speak, in a sense, and to be guided by the spirit in a way that it's not that one will understand, you know, maybe, how would you say, quantum mechanics, or one would understand sort of different traditions and ancient practices, and maybe, you know, shamanistic journeys into the, you know, or psychedelics or something like that. I just find that even on the individual level, that what one needs to work with in their life, they will be given. You know, if whether it's in relationships, whether it's just about, you know, being in touch with nature and finding their own true spirit, their own true calling, their own way of conduct, you know, of their own way of being a more righteous person, a more good-hearted person, a more compassionate person, that I think that there is something inside. That the more that you go inwardly, you know, that information or that direction will be given to you. You know, you will be, I really believe you will be inspired. And so we can't say that just, you know, somebody who says, well, I didn't have any books to read, I didn't have any great teachers or something like that. You know, you can't say that, because the greatest teacher is yourself, in a sense, first and foremost, and then everything else that represents that teacher inside, within the fractal universe that we live in. So I think it's available to all. I just don't think that anybody is really made to walk blindly without any kind of assistance and support. Yeah.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, just such a huge resonance.
Yeah, it's this is a great magic that works through all of our lives, and the timing is also is everything. I mean, it really, really is. You know, I did a talk on synchronicities and the magic of it. You know, for myself, I tell you, maybe it's out of my own sometimes longing, and sometimes for, you know, feeling again that when you met in a, you know, I live in the city, and when you met with the whole machine-like nature of a city, of the environment and the way that people operate and think, sometimes that the mystery, I would say, or the magnificence or the magic of life can feel very lost or not even achievable or accomplished. Like, you know, you wake up on a Monday morning and you feel the energy around you. I mean, today's Monday, you know, I wake up in the city and we discussed in the beginning the energies around me in the city and what I feel. And so for myself, you know, I can also feel despair and say, wow, you know, it's a whole new year and now it's the 9-to-5 and it's the business as usual and whatnot, and you know, all the problems and all the dramas that we're dealing with, and you kind of can lose touch with the existential moment in a sense. And for myself, that's also what my talks are about, is that we should never feel uninspired. We should never feel stuck because of the environment that we are in, or the people that we are surrounded by, in a way. We should never feel limited. We should never give ourselves over to that, you know, because there is so much more profundity going on. I mean, I talk about dreams as well, and dreams are so not to be overrated or underrated, I'm saying. I think for myself, they are a psychedelic journey on in themselves. They're truly an inspiration. It's a journey into another kind of realm and dimension, reality, where there is no real ego. You know, and I think we can learn so much from dreams. I mean, for those who don't have the internet, if you tap into your dreams, that can be your source of wealth of information and experience. And so for myself, I urge my listeners at times that when you wake up in the morning, you know, don't all of a sudden reach for your cell phone. You know, don't all of a sudden allow the day to take you away and start thinking, oh, well, you know, I got to get here and I got to do this and I got to pay my rent. And I mean, we have to function, yes, but give yourself some space and time. Let the dream resonate within you. Let it filter into your day. Recognize and see the unique difference of the space that you were just in. You know, and how mysterious it is. It's nothing like your waking state. There's nothing like it. In the dream state, it's timeless. It's this boundlessness, right? I mean, it's the impossible at the same time. And so for myself, I think that's in a way sometimes what I equate to is where we come from in a way, you know. And it's again the mind, biology conditioning our story that we've been led to believe something that we're not, whatever it is, our cultural story that sort of anchors us down into that, the 9-to-5, anchors us down into the body, into the flesh, you know, and this is all that there really is. And when you're so entangled and enmeshed in it, and the stresses of life are really overwhelming, and you don't have the peace of mind or a peace of heart to even, you know, have a bit of respite, have a bit of a breathing space. When you don't have that, you are so identified with whatever's going on externally of the story that you are in, you know, and you are so entangled in it, and you believe it all to be so true, and the finality of it, and you believe it almost sometimes to be this is how it is, and this is how it's going to be. And we lose touch with that mystery of that we you know, I kind of look at it as that we're on this journey, in this path, in this lifetime. It's like we've jumped onto a train and the train is traveling. And eventually, you know, when the time comes, we'll get off the train and there'll be another sort of experience beyond this life. This is sort of a passing, a channel, corridor, doorway, or passageway, in a sense. And so you don't want to, you know, sit down somewhere along the line and be completely, you know, that this is it. It's not. It's a temporal existence. And when you get in touch with the temporary nature of it, I think that's when you can get in touch with what is really real, in a sense. What really matters. You know, it doesn't matter to be well known by my community, or, you know, to be someone famous or wealthy or successful. Like, does that matter? Has that got any significance whatsoever? And you realize that it doesn't. You know, you realize that it's so insignificant that it doesn't amount to anything. There's no real reward in it. If there is a reward, it's very temporal, and then it dies out. It's very short-lived. And so you want to go for the heart of the matter, you know. And that's why it's so important to, like I said, for myself, be in touch with the magnificence of life, with the mystery of life, to be, you know, the imagination. The imagination is also just another tool as well. So again, just so we do not get tied in and so limited, and understand that this is all that there is, because there is so much more going on. And for myself, when I've taken psychedelics, this is one of the most important lessons that the psychedelic showed me, is that, you know, you can't you can't buy into the philosophy of your culture and society and whatnot. You cannot afford to believe at any, you know, for a longer period of time that you are just your flesh. You are just the material possessions that you have in this world. You're just your ego, your identification. Like there's a great cost comes with that, you know. A great cost comes with that, and so the importance of always being in touch with something that's transcendent, the transcendental, if you want to call it, is so important, because that way, when you do meet the transcendental, and I think we all do in our lives, you know, in certain moments of chaos, you know, in certain moments of joy, in certain, you know, maybe moments of nirvana or blissfulness or, you know, mindful meditation or something, when we meet the transcendental, that which is completely expansive, that which is boundless, that which is timeless, when you meet that, right, in what sort of, how are you going to manage the magnitude of that? How well equipped are you? You know, because like I said, you've been watching a movie, let's say, that you've been so in trained in, you've been so concentrated on, and that you haven't been realizing that the theater, the house that you're living in, has been burning down. So you've been so entranced by it, you've been so hypnotized by it, and then when you step away, when the credits roll and it's the end of the movie, and now all of a sudden you realize the reality that you're in, you don't want to, you know, be met with that, with absolute fear and paralyzation, in a sense. You know, that's the moment where you realize that what you have always been a part of, in a way, that which is so much larger than you could ever imagine. And so I think that's also what a process of our lives is about, is to be in touch with the transcendental, and keep that in our hearts, in a sense, because that's what we are a part of. And so I think that gives complement to the experience of being in a finite body for a temporal time with all its limitations, to realize what potential can be made and what potential can be brought forth, you know, within this limitation, within this time-bounded experience that we have, within the, you know, the limited the structure that we are in. So that's, I suppose, also my message, is about to be in touch with that which is transcendental. And I heard another word for, I don't really like the word God, but another word for God is the transcendental, you know. So I think that's what it's about, being in a relationship, you know, with the divine, you know, and working in this world, because when you are disconnected from that, right, then you got is the I wouldn't say the ego, in a sense, but all you got is man's rule, man's law, man's way, you know. And that's not going to serve one very well. I mean, if they're not into that kind of experience, if that's not what they came in to do. Yeah.
Certainly, you go through that planning and frustration, not always easy. But what are some ways that you find balance, and how you find the ability to balance yourself? And when we were talking, or as a second question, when we were talking about, you know, psychedelics and the transcendental, is there something that you could share from your experiences that had an impact on you?
Yeah, so I mean, I think there's many ways to many ways to answer that question. I'm just thinking which is the which kind of way to tackle that. I suppose for myself, and I don't know if this really does make sense, if it kind of answers the question in that way, is that I realized, and what helps me through it all is the intimacy with myself, right? And what I mean by that is that as I kind of feel that, I don't know if this will make sense, if I'm kind of the adult to the child inside.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sort of the captain of a ship, and the passenger is myself at the same time, if you want to call it that. And I have felt that it's important for me, well, first and foremost, this is, I think, how I was motivated, to get myself into good hands, into safe hands, and that was my own hands in a way, and my ability to be able to like myself, to be able to be compassionate with myself, to have myself as the most significant and important person in my life, and what will that take daily? You know, what will that take to be that? How can I create a safe space for myself? Because what I had found is that I was my own worst enemy. And I think we all become our own worst enemies to a degree when we are not self-aware, right? And for many reasons do we become our own worst enemy. We give into our own the insecurities that have been implemented into us and conditioned into us, and the fear of our uniqueness of the self that have been, you know, like for myself, I was doing incredible self-harm and I didn't even realize it. I didn't realize it. Even if you had come to tell me at the time, I would have said, who do you think you are? You know, and not only am I going to disagree with you, but I'm going to even, you know, take it to a next level, right? I'm almost going to be so stubborn and going to show you, like, if you come across and you say, look, man, and I was severely overweight and I was drinking a lot of booze, and you say, well, look, it's the best thing for you. I'd say, oh, well, what's the difference? Let me show you. You know, it's kind of like, and not to simplify too much, but that Homer Simpson kind of character. It's that, you know, how outrageously irresponsible can you get, you know? And so for myself, I found that I was on uncomfortable ground. I was on in not so safe territory with myself. I realized that I had this voice in my head, this critic, that was telling me throughout the day that what I was doing, you know, this is how I was also raised in a sense, but what I was doing was worthless, that I shouldn't try my hand at anything because I'm going to make a mistake, I'm going to screw up, people are going to laugh at me, you know, I'm not gifted enough, I haven't got, you know, a business mind, let's say, I just as an overall person, I've got no merit, I've got nothing really to feel good about myself, and therefore, it wasn't a problem for me to self-sabotage and to self-inflict unknowingly to myself. And so I became my own worst enemy. And so that is my greatest fear, is that I could do something that will be harmful to myself, because in the first place, I never had any awareness about what I was doing or any self-control to prevent myself from doing so. I mean, for myself, one example, I was drinking a lot of booze and then driving. So I'd go to the nightclub by myself, you know, and for many different reasons. And I would get into my car and I would go through traffic lights. I wouldn't even realize it. I'd go up one-way streets and I'd get home and I wouldn't even realize what I did. But when I started becoming more conscious and I reflected back on my actions, I realized what I was capable of doing. And that's maybe on small things. I did many other things. I would blame my family and publicly ridicule them, you know, for the way that they brought me up. I would write nasty letters and anonymous letters to old friends of mine who I felt, you know, just didn't understand me. I was very angry and I was acting in a way that I felt very shameful about for myself. And many other things I could probably go on for days about that, but I didn't find any reason to trust myself. I didn't find any reason. What reason was there? I was like, you know, I was out of control. And so what I learned for myself was to understand why I get out of control. What is it about me that feels so inferior, you know, that keeps putting myself down, that keeps criticizing me on everything that I do, that doesn't allow me to try new adventures or try new activities or meet new people, you know, what would tell me that I'm just not good enough for anything. Right. And so that was my issue. And so for myself, I needed to get myself to safe ground. And I needed to convince myself, in a sense, that I'm somebody who has redeemable qualities, that I'm somebody who's improved other people's lives at the same time. I've brought, you know, love and compassion and insight to other people's lives. I started projects on my own where I've inspired people, right? I've just done goodwill and assisted others. I mean, it was very important. And not only that, but then I could hold refuge in a way, or I could feel good about myself that I'd managed to not to get over the drinking, and to get, you know, over the bad patterns of behavior or something like that. I was able to move beyond just blaming people and taking responsibility for my own life. And so that gave me a sense of confidence that that I could achieve at things, that I could apply myself in my hand and have results that I could feel proud of, that I could feel, you know, confident by, that allowed me and led me to try my hand at many other things, many other activities, many other hobbies or interests or something like that, to get onto YouTube to make my videos. I mean, before, I struggled with the idea of making my own personal videos. I was like, who on earth wants to hear this guy ramble on about his own personal life? Like, who do you think you are? You know, there are so many other people out there that have so many more interesting things to say, with PhDs, you know, with tens and or decades of research. And here you come along, you know, Joe Schmo, taking up other people's bandwidth. Like, what are you doing? Taking up other people's time. And so I battled with that, and I said to myself, "No, man, you got to try it. You've got to go ahead with it." And then, you know, all the debate. Well, what are people going to think? And what if people don't like it? Will I be able to handle the rejection? And so, you know, don't try it because, you know, you won't be able to handle the rejection, and and you're putting yourself in danger. And that was the voice of the critic again. That was the authoritative voice in my head that I had been instilled with in my upbringing. And so I had to go, you know, say, this is my fears, you know, and face my fears in a sense, which was very, very scary, and overcome that, which I was challenged by, and turn that which I was challenged by into an opportunity. I never wanted to really forgive my parents for whatever they did, you know, at a certain time in my life. I never wanted to kind of even, you know, exist in this world or coexist with this world. Like, for what? You know, what kind of world do I want to be a part of? You know, I never wanted to even really wake up in the morning. This was in my, you know, very severe stages that I was in. And I thought, you know, reject the world, you know, give the middle finger to the man, you know, mom and pop, you know, who do you think you are? Whatever it was. Rebelliousness of all kinds, anarchistic nature of all kind, break all the rules. Do what thy will should be the whole of the law. That kind of thought. Anyways, and so I had a lot to work with, and I couldn't believe that, and I still can't believe it, that for myself now that I'm talking to, you know, folks like yourselves, that I have a YouTube channel, that I have subscribers, and I have people that are interested in watching and listening to what I have to say. And it's been an immense challenge, and each step along the way, I've had to, you know, be there for myself. And I suppose that's where I'll end off, is that I needed to be there for myself and self-nurturing all along the way. And even when I've made the terrible mistakes, you know, which weren't mistakes, they were just lessons and opportunities to learn how to better myself or try again from a different approach or a different angle, a different mindset. And I realized that, and I could refine myself and take, you know, note of that and take stock of that. And that's what I've spoken about in my talks, is how important it is to be aware of that which you have achieved, that which you have been successful at. And maybe it is, maybe it's a painting, maybe it's a drawing, maybe it's art, maybe it's, you know, a certain type of yoga, maybe you've been able to do meditation for a certain amount of times, maybe you did take that psychedelic that you're always afraid of taking. Take note, take stock of what it is that you have accomplished, how many people's lives that you've changed, how many people have you assisted, how many people have you told that you loved, you know, that goodness. To take stock of that goodness in order to carry it with you wherever you go, because, you know, the times will get dark. You'll have a dark night of the soul where you'll be lying in bed at 2 a.m. in the morning, you know, so restless, tossing and turning and thinking, the voice of the critic comes loud and screaming and says, who do you think you are, man? You know, what are you doing? You know, you're just a terrible, terrible voice. And you'll say, and you're just going to die or something, gets you crazy, or you're losing your mind. That used to be a favorite one of the critic in my head. It used to be like, man, you're tripping out too far here. Not even psychedelics. You're just tripping out too far. The internet has revolutionized your mind too quickly. You can't keep up with the pace of things. You know, you're figuring out, you know, sort of deep hidden mysteries of the planet, of the universe, of whatever it is. You can't handle it. You know, your vibration is too high. You know, you're going to go schizophrenic. You're going to lose your mind. And so I had to sit with myself and say, and face up to that and say, is this true? Do I allow this? Do I accept this? You know? And I realized that I would bring towards that all that I have achieved, all that I have gained, my mindfulness, right? My focus, my attention, my dedication, whatever it was. And I would bring to that critic, I'd bring to that darkness, and I would say, this is what I have to show you. And so, you know, this is what I've been working with. This is what I've accomplished. And where do you stand now? How much sense, how much reasoning does the voice of the critic have now? You know, the shadow self, in a sense, I mean, not to generalize things, but that voice inside that I've been living with for so long. So again, I think, supposed to come back to your question, I think that's what it's about. I think it's about the working with oneself daily. And whatnot, I'd say.
Wonderful. And with your works, you not only overcome your fears, but you also are helping others to overcome them too. So that's just amazing what you do. So I also wanted to ask you about, maybe there are some other projects you do besides your work on YouTube, and maybe there are some other hobbies you would share too with the world.
I don't know if they're any of particular interest, I would say. I do some vegetable gardening. I've determined to learn how that works. So that's kind of a hobby for myself. It's a project that I take quite seriously, in a sense. I'm also about the fact that when we do have free time on our hands, that we spend it in a very productive manner, you know. I mean, yes, I enjoy watching movies and things like that, but not hours, you know, endless hours, or maybe playing, you know, PlayStation or PC games for an endless amount of times, or spending, you know, time on the internet mindlessly, I would say. But I'm very much of trying to be constructive with my time. So one of the projects, I would say, is my gardening. And otherwise, I mean, I can get more into detail, which is not very interesting. I kind of run a massage shop, a massage spa, that I started with my girlfriend about 2 years ago. That was very synchronistic. That wasn't planned for at all. And that was just amazing. The idea for myself was that to offer people a way to heal, a space of tranquility, of relaxation, of healing, I would say. And I kind of designed the spa to be quite natural, even though it's in a shopping center, which hopefully one day we'll get out of and relocate to maybe somewhere more in nature, or with a garden or something like that. But just sort of set it up with bamboo inside and fake flowers, because you can't really put anything alive in there. But just to create, again, a place of harmony and a place of peacefulness for people to come and experience. And I mean, I've been thinking about, I don't know if I'd find that I just find that there aren't, and I've gotten onto the internet here, the local internet, to try and find a group of people that would like to get together and have, you know, sort of meaningful conversations, and a sort of a group, if you want to call it. But I've tried that for several years and I haven't found anybody of the same mind of nature. We're interested in that. I did kind of do it for a short time in space, but most people came for the social part of it, to like sort of meet, you know, a potential partner or something like that. They never came for what it was really about. So it kind of was I was a bit disheartened about that. But I kind of run this massage shop. I don't do the massage myself, but that was, I suppose, maybe you could say another sort of side project, and also to help somewhat financially with things.
Yeah, well, that's wonderful. You know, you're doing your own thing. That's what it's all about. And reconnecting with nature, I think, is just another way that we all have to start again doing, you know. And I do a vegetable garden myself, and I've got a few chickens, and it's so much fun. It's, you know, it's what it's all about. I mean, And they do become great projects, and it's a lot of fun time spent. And you start thinking, you know, and you go back to who am I, and kind of how you just put it all together. It's just great to hear a story like that, and see how that turns into, you know, reaching a lot of people with that love, you know, with that nutrition. Number one, nutrition for humanity, love, you know. And so I enjoyed it very much listening to your story. Maybe we can do it again in the future. We certainly thank you a whole bunch for spending time with us here and talking a little bit of background about yourself. It's always great to hear these personal stories, how we overcome our personal separations, and then, you know, find new ways to integrate in this great unity, and then still preserve our individual qualities. It's that's just I guess that's the path, you know. That's what we all gotta go through. So thank you so much, and
thank you. Thank you as well. It's been so one-sided, the conversation, which is obviously the way we've set it up. And I'm curious by nature. It was wonderful for me to speak and whatnot. But I'm also curious of your own stories and for yourself. I mean, perhaps maybe we can make another time. And if you're up for it, I mean, I don't know. I would just like to know how you initially started this project. I've seen you guys have been online on YouTube. You've made a number, I don't know how many videos of with so many interesting people, and you know, hours and hours of really of rewarding material and valuable material and insight. So I thank the two of you as well for doing your share and doing your part. And I don't know, hopefully we can connect again in the future. And if you're up for it, I'd also like to hear a little bit about yourselves. I don't know if you've had the opportunity, or if you would like to, if you feel comfortable as well, to maybe have more of an open chat as well. Well, not open, sure. But both-sided.
Yeah. Yeah, always a pleasure. Yeah, so just we have to arrange time, and yeah, amazing would be.
Yeah, some round tables with a few people. It's always a great way to exchange quickly. Absolutely.
Yeah, that's something that I would maybe like to in the future start on my channel. I would like to have, I like that word, round table of you know, because for myself doing the talks, it's just me on my own. I would love to have some kind of feedback or some kind of dialogue with people at the same time. So, you know, the more the merrier, and more magic can happen that way. And that's something, you know, I hope to also bring to my channel as well.
Yeah. Very cool.
So basic idea of how we started our show was like we wanted to, you know, unite all the spheres into one. So that's why, you know, those conversations are truly helping to, you know, show people how everything is so similar and coming from one source. So that was
right.
The idea. Yeah. So
yeah.
Well, congratulations on that. And I mean, I wish you all the best with it. And I'm very honored that you have invited me on your show. And I have been looking forward to some. I'm absolutely blessed that to be on your show, and that we've made it happen is spectacular. So thank you for the experience and the opportunity.
Thank you. It was a pleasure to talk to you. Really, just amazing.
Right.
All
right. Thank you very much.
Talk soon, Aron. Thanks.
Chat soon. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Take care. Hey? Bye.
Take care.
Well, I definitely think we're on that there is a process that has been long underway, that has been gaining momentum since its very beginning. It's the process which formed the planet, which called life out of the ocean, which called higher animals out of lower animals, which called humanity out of the primates, and which called history out of tribal, sacral, timeless existence. And what it is leading toward is some kind of apocalyptic, transformative flowing together of everything that is beyond our language system. It's the umbilicus of being. It's where it's all tied together, and therefore it's very hard to describe it. I think that all of our science and our religion and our history, these are patterns thrown across a limited set of dimensions by the hyperdimensional fact of a certain object at the end of history toward which we are moving, to which we are being drawn. I think that most things about man are mysterious, and that what is happening to us is mysterious. The sudden explosive development of the neocortex is entirely out of context with what we know about the rates of evolution that go on in other species and previously went on in the primates. Now, it's been very fashionable in the past, you know, I don't know, 50 years or something, to think that it's all very humdrum somehow, and yet this is just everybody, every ideological system that has been granted the status of being the official view of reality has always proclaimed that it had everything nailed down but the last 5%, and their best people were working on that. But I think that we are, for all that we know practically nothing. And that though I am not in any sense of the... well, not in any sense, but in most senses, I am not religious. I think that religious thinking about the transformation of the world is more on the right track than the notion that the laws of physics will always be what they are, the laws of biology will always be what they are, and we're all just going to go along and things are going to get worse and worse, or better and better, but that there are no surprises. I think that we do not see what's going on. One of the reasons I like to make this argument about the mushroom and the extraterrestrial and all that is just to show people that maybe this isn't true, but look how you can see things differently. If things can be seen that differently, how many ways can they be seen differently? And to try and get people to realize, to stop waiting for the president to enlighten you. In other words, stop waiting for history and the stream of historical events to make it clear to you. You have to take seriously the notion that understanding the universe is your responsibility, because the only understanding of the universe that will be useful to you is your understanding. It doesn't do you any good to know that somewhere in some computer there are tensor equations which perfectly model or perfectly don't model something that's going on. And we have all tended to give away ourselves to official ideologies and to say, well, I may not understand, but someone understands. But the fact of the matter is, only your own understanding is any good to you. I mean, because it's you that you're going to live with, and it's you that you're going to die with. And as the song says, you know, the last dance you do alone, and you want to be in good company then. So, it's very important to cultivate this aspect of yourself and to be with it. I don't know what the transformation means, this rushing together of everything, but I think without knowing what it means, you can convince yourself that it's there, it's just nobody has chronicled it, or no official agency has pointed out that things are developing faster and faster. Things are growing together faster and faster. Connections are being formed faster and faster. The evolution of language, technology, understanding of the self, these things are just spinning into a tizzy. And it will not go away. It will go through. It will break through to something else. And we may have to shed the present human guiding image. We may have to shed the monkey body. We have to be open. Very open. What is happening on this planet, if you stand off by a nearby star and look at it, is there is information loose on this planet. A swarm, a gene swarm of replicating information, which has become so complexified that it now generates swarms of epigenetic information, meaning books, architectures, mythologies, all of these things. And information is liberating itself. And what is that? And what does that mean? You know, the Gnostics had the idea that God's body had been scattered through the universe as light, and that the purpose, the salvational imperative, was to gather the light together and get it out of this universe and transmit it back to the modality of its essence. And that's a good metaphor for what is going on. But no one understands it, I think. But we can understand aspects of it. We are lagging. There is enough visible that we should be saying more about what's happening. And I don't hear that being said. Maybe it's being said privately. Maybe it's a taboo subject. Perhaps the attraction for some people of these lectures is that they somehow violate taboos, that impossible things are being said. Maybe, maybe not. But impossible things need to be said, because impossible things are happening, and you don't want to miss it. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure to talk to you about this. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did.